Behold, I come quickly. Hold that fast which thou hast, that no man take thy crown.
Mukesh Ambani, fourth on the list of the world's richest people, has a net worth of $29 billion. He decided to invest his wealth into his home. He built an incredible 27-story skyscraper just for personal use. The building is worth approximately $2 billion. It has 4 million square feet of interior space and stands 550 feet above Mumbai's slums, watching over the poverty-stricken land juxtaposed to the incredible building reaching for the sky. The home has over 600 caretakers making sure the household functions. It is the world's most expensive private residence, after the Buckingham Palace. Sheikh Hamad bin Abdan Al Nahyan is a member of the Abu Dhabi royal ruling family in the United Arab Emirates. The Sheikh is also one of the world's wealthiest people, being a retired diplomatic worker. The billionaire got worldwide attention when he decided to invest in quite a spectacular, although pretty pointless endeavor. Sheikh Hamad owns a private island, and he decided to leave a permanent mark on the land. He had his name carved into the earth by digging so deep that the lines of the letters are actually waterways. Each letter is a kilometer tall. The point was to have his name visible from the moon. With a signature visible from space, he wanted to prove that he is indeed larger than life. Saudi Prince Al Waleed is an avid automobile collector. For the 38th piece in his collection, he decided to get something special, which led to the extravagant purchase of this one-of-a-kind vehicle. He bought a diamond-encrusted Mercedes-Benz. Amongst other jewels, the car is decorated with Swarovski crystals. The body, the tailpipe, the wheel rims, the logo, and even the door handles are covered in diamonds, making this one of the world's most expensive cars, and certainly the most luxurious one. The prince paid $48 million for his prized possession. Reportedly, he is actually earning money off of it, as he allegedly charges $1,000 for letting a person come close to the car and touch it.
Items of clothing ever made cost a cool $250,000, and it's quite a sight to see.
Partnership teamed together and designed a bottle made out of gold and platinum with 6,500 diamonds housing a 100-year-old cognac.
Number 25. At least 80% of humanity lives on less than $10 per day. Number 24. To put things into perspective, the top 20% of the world's population accounts for 3/4 of the world's income. Number 23. Half of the world's population accounts for only 5% of the world's income. Number 22. According to UNICEF, 22,000 children die every day due to poverty. Number 21. Nearly 1/3 of children in developing countries are estimated to be underweight or stunted. Number 20. Last year, about 70 million children of primary school age were not in school. Number 19. Nearly 1 billion people celebrated the coming of the 21st century without being able to read a book or sign their name. Number 18. Preventable diseases like malaria afflict nearly 500 million people every year. Number 17. Africa alone accounts for roughly 1 million deaths due to malaria annually. Most of them are children. Number 16. Speaking of children, there are 2.2 billion children in the world. Number 15. Half of them live in extreme poverty. Number 14. Over 1 billion people have inadequate access to water and 2.6 billion lack basic sanitation. Many times this means there's no separation of drinking water and toilet water. Number 13. That's why 1.8 million children die every year of diarrhea. Number 12. Approximately half of the world's population now lives in cities, and about 1/3 of those in the cities live in slum conditions. Number 11. In fact, slum growth is outpacing urban growth by a frighteningly large margin. Number 10. 1/4 of humanity lives without electricity. Number 9. The 7 richest people in the world make more than the poorest 41 countries combined. That's roughly 567 million people. Number 8. 0.14% of the world's population owns over 80% of the world's private financial wealth. The vast majority of that wealth has managed to avoid all income and estate taxes, either by the countries where it's been invested or where it comes from. Number 7. For every $1 in aid that a developing country receives, over $25 is spent on debt repayment. Number 6. The poorer the country, the more likely it is that the debt repayments are being extracted directly from the people who neither contracted the loans nor received any money. Number 5. In 1998, $8 billion was spent on cosmetics in the United States. $11 billion was spent on ice cream in the European Union. $17 billion was spent on pet food in Europe and the US. $100 billion was spent on alcohol in Europe. $400 billion was spent on narcotics globally, and $780 billion was spent on militaries around the world. Number 4. In the same year, $6 billion was spent on achieving basic education for all, $9 billion was spent on basic water and sanitation, and $13 billion was spent on basic health and nutrition for all. Number 3. If you're reading this list, then you are in the top 30% of the world's population when it comes to poverty and wealth. Number 2. With new technologies, we now grow enough food to feed 10 billion people, or 1.5 times the world's population. The problem is that most of the world can't afford to buy that food. And number 1. If the world spent less than 1% of what it spends on weapons, all the previously mentioned issues would be fixed.
The whole idea of celebrity and fame has become really convoluted and, you know, kind of bastardized, like, whereas fame used to be the byproduct of success, and now it's the ultimate goal. And you, if your ultimate goal is to be famous, then you're going to do a lot to get there, like sign your name in blood in a contract with the devil. Like, you're going to end up on a one-way street, and it's going nowhere. Like, that's just the truth. I've seen so many people, like, forsake their moral code and their value systems just for a little bit of fame, and it's not worth it at the end of the day. It's really not worth it.
He did suffer brain damage, which is permanent, unfortunately.
They call him the miracle child. A machete was sliced through Alan's head and neck in an attempt to behead him. He was also castrated. The work of witch doctors, attempting child sacrifice.
You see, this is where the cut was. There is a bone missing here.
The 9-year-old's mutilated body was found just a mile from his home. It was a month before he woke from a coma. Doctors are surprised Alan survived, but he will need a lifetime of emotional and physical therapy. Child sacrifice, a juju ritual, was rare here until 3 years ago, when it re-emerged, coinciding with a boom in Uganda's economy. It's widely believed that some members of the new elite are paying witch doctors vast sums of money for an ancient practice, in the belief it'll bring them greater wealth and good health. But these people do not sacrifice their own children.
Police in Thailand have arrested a British man over a suspected black magic ritual involving the dead bodies of babies. We'd like to warn you that you may find the following images disturbing. Police say the bodies of six children aged 7 months to 2 years were found stuffed in bags in a Bangkok hotel room. Some were covered in gold leaf. The suspect, 28-year-old Chow Hock Quen, is a British citizen born in Hong Kong. He's being held for possession of human remains. Police believe he was trying to smuggle the corpses to Taiwan and sell them to wealthy clients. It's not known where the bodies came from.
Who had money and who didn't have money, and who was paying tithes and who wasn't paying tithes, mm-hmm. because it was always slightly mentioned, no names were given, mm-hmm. but you could kind of tell who it was, mm-hmm. and that's why you kind of felt pressured in giving money. If you don't pay your tithes, God can't bless you, and if you pay your tithes, you'll get 100-fold more, mm-hmm. and things like that. And you'd be like sitting there thinking, but you know what, I don't think God is into money per se. Mm-hmm. You know, you have a testimony, oh, God sent me a check through the post for £2,000. God didn't send you no check, it's your tax rebate. And as sad as it is, that's what church has become. It's become a materialistic, status, capitalistic, all about the money. It's no longer about who we know or helping, or they put it under the guise of helping. Mm-hmm. But really, are they really helping, or are they just helping themselves?
I'd feel strange about the clergyman being very wealthy and the congregation being very poor. If the congregation were being encouraged to pay towards the church and that money was going towards the ministers.
Jesus was always talking about, he said how hard it is for the rich man to enter the kingdom of heaven, which shows he's not, Jesus is not into people lining their pockets with money. That's not the point of life on this earth. So for a Christian minister to be focusing on money and getting rich doesn't line up with the Bible.
God was becoming less of a priority and us pursuing wealth and possessions was becoming more of a priority. That's all we talked about. That's all we thought about. We would have, we had this book where we put all of our dreams, and we would have these things that we would recite every day. Me and my husband would hold hands and we would recite these things like, we believe that we have this money and we can feel it in our hands. We are now awaiting a plan from God by which to accumulate this money, and when we receive that plan, we will follow it. But it seems more like we were trying to speak them into existence more than we were getting God's guidance on if this was His will. We knew that we still had this void, and we felt that we felt such a disconnect from Jesus the more and more that we pursued all of these things. And till one day, I think God just smacked both of us. And it was then, it was a certain day, we had been on the phone arguing for hours. And at that moment, both of us said to ourselves, we are not in God's will. We're just gonna forget all of this stuff about prosperity and trying to find wealth and possessions. And we're just gonna get back to seeking God and find out what God really wants from us.
If I never own a mansion way out on a hill,
we started reading the word more. We started asking God to fill us with His Holy Spirit more. And for the first time, we started thinking to ourselves, what does it mean to be satisfied in Jesus alone? If the ultimate thing that we're supposed to be doing is to bring glory to God, how more is it that you can bring glory to God than to denounce everything that seems valuable to you and say, you know what, Jesus is more valuable to me than pursuing money and wealth, and He is my only source of joy. And for the first time in a long time, we felt joy and we had peace, and we felt that we were finally in God's will. And we felt, and we had never felt that way, and it felt like we were experiencing Jesus for the first time.
He which testifieth these things saith, surely I come quickly. Amen. Even so, come, Lord Jesus.